If you have high ferritin, are there any downsides to blood donation?
Hi, I'm Chris Masterjohn, and I have a PhD in nutritional sciences. I am not a medical doctor, and nothing contained in this episode may be construed as medical or nutritional advice of any kind or a substitute, therefore. This episode is meant purely as scientific education. If you wish to act on any ideas presented in this episode, please consult your physician first and never take anything herein as a reason to contradict medical advice. With that said, enjoy the episode.
So my question is, if one's ferritin is high, is there any downside to doing voluntary blood donation?
Not really. Although I wouldn't look just at your ferritin. So you should look at ferritin, look at transferrin saturation, and make sure everything's consistent with too much iron. But the main thing that you want to look at is your marker, your complete blood count, to look at your markers of anemia and make sure that none are there prior and that none develop. And so, you know, generally speaking, even if your iron stores aren't crazy high, as long as you don't become deficient in iron, you're fine. And so if everything looks like it's iron overload, you don't have to be 100% certain that you need the blood donation. You just have to make sure it doesn't make you deficient. And so just retest those markers, 4 to 8 weeks after you give blood. And then as long as nothing goes abnormal, and if you're on the edge, you know, like if your ferritin gets down to, say, 60 or something like that, and you're like, is this too low or not? I would also keep an eye on your thyroid function and just on how you feel. You know, if you feel fatigued for 8 weeks after donating blood, lay off it for a while. But there's not really any downside other than the acute downsides that everyone knows about. Like you might faint or you might develop hypoglycemia or something from the loss of fluid. But, you know, besides those, there's not really any long-term damage besides losing too much iron.
Okay. Okay, that's helpful. I have my next consultation with you in October, but my ferritin is pretty high, so I was just wondering what to do in the meantime.
Yeah, well, yeah, I think donating blood is fine, and generally speaking, most of the adaptations that take a few days, but they kind of take like 2 months to fully occur, and that's why they make you wait 2 months to donate again. So generally the best time to do follow-up lab work to just make sure nothing got disturbed would be like in the 4 to 8 week period after the blood donation, just to make sure that most of those adaptations have gone through. Like your red blood cells will certainly go down the day of your blood donation because you just took a bunch of them out. But, you know, 4 weeks later, they're probably going to be back to normal. And they should be. Yeah.
Okay. Okay. That's good to know.
Great. Anything else? Thank you very much. You're welcome.
This episode was part of a Q&A for members of the CMJ MasterPass, where I hold monthly private Zoom Q&As for my members. The MasterPass also serves as a buyer's club with exclusive and massive discounts on your favorite premium foods and health products, including pasture-raised and wild meat and seafood, supplements, sleep accessories, water filters, phototherapy devices, and much more. If you'd like to participate in these Q&As, you can join the MasterPass at chrismasterjohnphd.com/masterpass and use the code Q&A, spelled Q-A-N-D-A, Q&A, for 10% lifetime discount. I am currently working full-time on finishing my first book, Vitamins and Minerals 101, How to Get the Nutrients You Need on Any Diet. I will let you know when I have a release date. In the meantime, you can pre-order the book at chrismasterjohnphd.com/book. Testing Nutritional Status, The Ultimate Cheat Sheet, has been newly released as version 1.3. This is my comprehensive system for managing nutritional status with lab tests, dietary analysis, and comprehensive intake of your signs and symptoms. The new version has a comprehensive guide to interpreting the Genova methylation panel. You can pick up your copy at chrismasterjohnphd.com/cheat sheet. In my consulting, I am neither a medical practitioner nor a coach. I serve as your data analyst and your strategist. I teach you scientific principles of health and wellness, help you analyze your data, and help brainstorm actionable strategies. You can sign up for a consultation at chrismasterjohnphd.com/consultations. Please consider supporting my work at no extra cost to you by visiting my support page and making a purchase with one of my affiliate links. Some of my most popular affiliates are also listed in the description of this video with links that will give me credit for your purchase. I will try to respond to comments when I can, but my presence will be intermittent while I'm finishing my book. I hope you enjoyed this, and I will see you in the next episode.